Thanks, thanks, Farah, and thanks, everybody. But listen. So first of all, let's start from the beginning. Constitution making is actually a negotiated agreement. So what we did was to go to the people of Kenya and ask them, what kind of constitution do you want? How do you want to be governed? And for me, and it starts from the Constitution Review Act of 2008, which defined the organs of review. The first organ of review there was the Committee of Experts, which I was a CEO. Then there was a Parliamentary Select Committee. Then there was the reference group, and then there was the people of Kenya, I mean the National Assembly, people can eventually. So all these organs had to work together. And what we did as the Committee of Expertise, whenever we came up with a draft, we will send it to the Parliamentary Select Committee, and Honorable Farah Halim will confirm that. We will have a session with them where we will discuss what do you guys think about this, about this decision. And so constitution making process really is about negotiation. It's about how do we bring together the will of the people. And that's exactly what happened in Kenya, because and like Abdul Rashid said, Parliament tried to kill this constitution by introducing about, I think, I believe, about 300 amendments. They were not able to do it, yeah, until when we went to the referendum. So the people had to make a choice about whether they want the Constitution 2010 or not. So everything about constitution making process in was is about negotiation. And I think maybe just to take it outside Kenya, if you look at the constitution making process in the last 10, 15 years in Africa, you can see the shift that sovereign authority now vests in the people, not in the political leadership of a country. And that's why you'll see Article 1 of the Constitution of Kenya talks about that sovereign authority vests in the people, that they can exercise it directly or indirectly through their elected representatives. So a shift is happening in Africa today as we speak about constitutionalism. If I can quote my late professor Okoth Ogendo, he used to tell us that constitution without constitutionalism is not constitution. So I think the challenge right now in Africa and in Kenya, in my view, is are we enforcing the constitution as it ought to be? And maybe this is one great lesson for Somalia. Can we involve the people to decide what is it that they actually want? How do they want to be governed as a people? That's the biggest question when you're going to do constitution making. So I think what you are speaking to is what we call constitutional design. How do you design a constitutional making process? What are the structures, the frameworks that you put in place for a constitution to be successful? Constitutional design means the planning, the structures, the organs of that constitutional making body. And I think that has to be defined articulately. Without that, then you cannot have a proper constitution making process. The credibility of the Committee of Experts. First of all, these jobs were advertised, and we went for parliamentary vetting. We were vetted. So for me, it was about compliance with the Constitution of Kenya, Constitution Review Act of 2008. Yeah. So there's a law that we needed to comply with. So I think maybe for Somalia as a lesson is you need to establish a law that will decide or define who actually sits in your constitution making body. And then agree, what are the organs of constitutional review? Perhaps you can borrow from Kenya. There's absolutely nothing wrong with borrowing from best examples. So in 2008, we had a Constitutional Review Act of 2008, and it clearly defined what the criteria is, who can actually apply for that position, and that's what happened. So for me, in terms of credibility, we are the best members of the Committee of Experts, and I'm happy that even my brother Abdulrashid Abdullahi, not being a lawyer, coming from outside the legal profession, yes, so he was able to actually inject some wisdom in constitution making, because constitution making is not just about law, it's a totality of everything. And I'm sure Honorable Farah Mahalim can confirm that, now that at least he is a lawyer. But by that time he wasn't a lawyer, but he was able to at least appreciate the legalities, the issues around constitutional making and matters legal.
Well, how we were recruited into becoming members of the Committee of Experts was that over 600 Kenyans applied for positions. You know, once we had the post-election violence, Kenya was on downhill. You know, post-election violence on the country was actually teetering on civil war. But, you know, the AU, the UN, and also some the Western world came in to save, you know, to talk to the politicians on both sides, on all sides. And after that, then the country had... you know, the politicians came to their senses and they started, you know, talking together across the table. And as a result of that discussion, a lot of commissions were set up. One of them was the Committee of Experts. The second one was the TJRC, and I'm sure Honorable Farah will talk about those commissions. TJRC Truth, TJ Justice Reconciliation Commission, TJRC. There was also the National NCIC, National Cohesion and Integration Commission. There was also the Commission on the Implementation of the Constitution. So there were various, you know, bodies that were set up to resolve the issues that Kenyans were fighting over, of which the major ones was, one, the failure, the loss of trust of the judiciary. And Kenyans reached a point where they said, why hire a lawyer when you can buy the judge? Meaning that there was, even if, you know, Raila Odinga lost the election and Kibaki would have said, go to the judiciary. But then Kenyans have lost faith and trust in the constitution, I mean, in the judiciary. Therefore, that was one of the causes of the, you know, post-election violence and the rest. But how we were recruited is, over 600 Kenyans applied. Out of the 600 Kenyans who applied for that position, 50 of them were selected. Out of that 50 who were selected for, you know, these positions, I remember we were only three Somalis, myself, Ahmed Nasir, and Fadhuma Shukri, who was the daughter of General Mahmoud. And the who is who in the legal fraternity of Kenya, from Khaminywa to the late, you know, Nzamba Kitonga, to who is who, they were all there, they were interviewed. We all went through the interview process. And I was one of them. Ikuru was also not part of that interview, but he will tell us how many applied for the CEO to become the chief executive officer, because it was also a constitutional office. We could not sack, you know, Ikuru, as, you know, he was totally, while he worked with the committee, but still, his office was constitutional. That means we could not sack him as we wished or as any member wished. So the thing is, once we were sworn in, we had to follow, you know, the act, parliament. And I think that's Honorable Farah should have spoken about that. There was a parliamentary act that was guiding the committee of experts. And that act stipulated A, B, C, D, how we were to do our work. And the most important thing was we had to look at what sort of controversial issues that divided the country. We had to go across the country and identify what really divided the country. Mahal wadanki kala fogeynaya, mahal isku haysta, mahal isku dagaalaya wadanki Kenya. And we had to, you know, get that out from the people. And then secondly, we had to, you know, put aside what Kenyans had no issue with, what the Kenyans had no issues with, or they were all agreeable to. Marka, we already did that. We went around the country, you know, collecting all those views of Kenyans. And we kind of did a draft. We were all put in a boardroom. The committee of experts had the face of Kenya. We had three experts from, one from Zambia, who was a professor of law, Chaloko Bayani. In fact, he wants to join us right now, here and now, but he doesn't know how. Inshallah, we'll have another space for him. And then we had Professor Christina Mari. She's also a professor of law. Right now, she's also at LSE. And then the last foreigner was the former chairman of the Constitutional Review of Uganda, the man who wrote the constitution of, who led and guided the constitution of Uganda. And then Ikuru Okot, he was also there with us. He was he's a constitutional lawyer. And luckily also Liberia in 2011, after we delivered the Kenyan constitution, he's the one who guided the constitution of Liberia. And that's why Liberia is also able to, you know, they are more stable and more, you know, kind of democratic than after they emerged from the civil war. And you can talk to that about it. So the thing is, we had a time frame to deliver the constitution. We were sworn in February, I think March 2009. And by August 2010, we had the constitution. The constitution was promulgated openly by President Kibaki at Uhuru Park. And then by December 2010, we had to fold up and go to the streets and, I mean, go your way, so to speak. So for me, we had a lot of, you know, issues that we all sat. But then, luckily, and I'm saying this openly, we had a non-opinionated, he had no opinions of his own, chairman of the Committee of Experts. He will listen to all of us. And then at the end of a particular article or a particular sentence or whatever, we'll take a vote. If we were tied in that vote, the chairman will have two votes to move that, but to accept and move that. And then every committee of experts had an assistant, a PA, who will draft everything for him and must be a lawyer. And then also sitting with us in that boardroom were drafters. And you know, legal drafters, they are lawyers, they are highly qualified, they have a specialized skill in drafting law. Okay, none of us, committee of members, drafted it with our hands. They will sit there, the drafters will sit there, listen to us, and draft the constitution. They will bring it to us back, and we will debate and accept it. And that's how the constitution was written. Alhamdulillah, as Honorable Farah said, and by the way, he was my mentor from childhood. So let me just, I'm sorry to say that. And none of us, I mean, none of the politicians, one or two came to the boardroom. That's where we were drafting, we were discussing the constitution. And they all had their own interest. For example, I'll be honest, I mean, there's nothing to hide. The member of parliament for Kuria is a small, you know, constituency, or they have two, three constituencies, and they are a minority who feel they have been marginalized by the larger Luo community. So they wanted a county of their own. He came several times, pleading, pressuring us. The other one was another member of parliament from Northeastern. She wanted, they wanted a county of their own. County, because counties come with their own budgets. They are given, you know, it's a devolved system. So it had its own, you know, local governments. So there was not much interference politically. But then within the board members, you can sense who is driving their ideas to where. There was some sort of alignment. They will not come out in the open. But then I and Bobby, who's here, Bobby Mkangi, somewhere, he's listening somewhere, or he'll be passing by. And a few others we had no interest. You know, the bigger tribes in Kenya, the Luo, the Kikuyu, they will want, you know, a bigger share. They want to see their system or their governance system to be highlighted, or their interest to be highlighted. But then, as I said, we had three foreigners who are non-biased, who have no interest, and who will correct us Kenyans who are, you know, fighting one another on behalf of some outside interest. But then, alhamdulillah, we were able to overcome all those. The chairman, you know, the late chairman Nzamba Kitonga, will steer these tense discussions. And then at the end of the day, the committee came up amicably and, you know, with compromise, give and take, in the interest of the country, we were able to deliver that constitution, as Abdelrazak Hashia said, was approved by 67% of the population. First, yeah, so that is it. It was a bit, you know, tiresome. It was a good thing. But at the end of the day, even Ikuru Akwot here, he's listening here. He tried to change the constitution himself, the constitution that he wrote. But he was unsuccessful, and he will tell us.
Thank you very much, Abdelrazak.
Even Uhuru Kenyatta tried to change, but he could not change the constitution. Anyway, thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you very much.
So if you might focus the consultation process, you know, the inclusiveness of the process, for example, the role of the civil society, like, for example, the role of the religion leader, religious leaders, the role of women, the minorities, all of these, even though Somalia and Kenya cannot be, you know, compared, you know, when it comes, you know, these factors. But we would like you to also highlight and focus these, you know, these parts. Thank you.